Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This week marks the 2-year anniversary of the first COVID-19 lockdown. I'd just like to take a moment to acknowledge those who have sadly lost a loved one to COVID-19 and to reflect on the many challenges that we have faced, or individuals have faced, in the wider society over the past 2 years in dealing with the pandemic. We banged up pots and we clapped on our doorsteps in appreciation of the NHS, but it's important that we still acknowledge that our NHS this week has never been under so much pressure. Yesterday we had over 2,257 COVID cases in hospital and over 5,000 NHS staff absences. We all appreciate how difficult this is for our NHS, and I'd like to, on behalf of the committee, give a heartfelt thanks for the ongoing work in such challenging circumstances. This morning, the committee will continue to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Adam Statura, the Head of Policy and Communications for Aged Scotland, Douglas Hendry, Executive Director of Argyll and Bute Council, Fiona Blair, President of Association of Registers of Scotland, Mari Miller, Head of Licensing and Democratic Services at Glasgow City Council, and David McNeill, Director of Development, Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisation. A warm welcome and thank you for giving us your time this morning. The focus on this meeting is the remote delivery of public services where these are enabled by Part 3 of the Bill. Each member of the committee will have approximately 12 minutes to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. We should be okay for time this morning. However, I apologise in advance if time runs on too much. I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of keeping us to time. Thank you. I'd like to now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. If I can start on digital exclusion, I note from the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisation blog that over 1.5 million people have started to use the internet in the UK since 2020. And according to a recent Scottish Household Survey report, at the moment 93% of households have access to the internet and 92% of adults use the internet. However, deprivation is a significant factor, and only 87% of households in our most deprived areas have access to internet. However, one of my concerns is with the living cost crisis hitting households averaging about £3,000 a year, people will still start to make decisions where their money will be spent, either in heating and food, and perhaps more people may become more digitally excluded. Can I ask what other risks may arrive from the move to digital delivery of public services? And if I could please start with Adam Statura.
Thank you very much, convener. I think from Age Scotland's point of view, we've heard a lot from older people over 50, their family and carers over the last 2 years in particular, about how inaccessible public services and the things they come to rely on, such as banking and other such important things, access to health, how inaccessible they have been, not just as a result of the pandemic, but before that. And you know, people desperately need this. You've mentioned the point about digital exclusion and areas of deprivation. Well, 50% of older people in the most deprived parts of Scotland don't use the internet, and often these are the people who will rely on public services the most, whether that's health or any other kind of support. So there is a very difficult challenge to address here. But I think one of the things that's quite important is also to remember that not everyone will be able to get online, whether that's through disability, whether that's through poverty, and actually, quite frankly, whether that's also through choice. And people who just have never used such a thing, and the older you get, you might be living with different health conditions, which might preclude you from doing so. Now, we're not suggesting in any way, in a Luddite fashion, that older people can't get online. There's been a great adoption of this through the necessities, whether it's been video calls or other such things to kind of connect people, but there are really profound challenges for folks to get online, actually realising the platforms that they go, whether it's local authority, the NHS, other places, GP surgeries, are actually pretty hard to navigate too. So just because you can get there doesn't mean you can find what you're looking for or do what you're intended to.
Thank you very much. Could I bring in David McNeill for that same question, please?
Yeah, and I suppose it's important to say that I suppose digital public services is the way that, you know, most people expect to interact. It's faster, more convenient, and if it's done right, it's cheaper to deliver. But that digital services isn't about, you know, just putting our existing services online. It's about, you know, redesigning those services to how people expect to interact with them and how they want to interact with them. But also recognising, I think, to Adam's point, that some people, there is a proportion of people that don't want to engage in that way or can't engage in that way, and to not leave those people behind. I think digital exclusion to us has three components. One is about the confidence and motivation to go online, and that refers to, I think, lots of those people that aren't online or don't want to go online. And what we know from pre-pandemic, around half of that group do want to engage online, they just need the some support to do so. But there are a group of you know, resistors who don't want to engage. So alternative methods to providing those public services are pretty important to providing that service. The other components relate to wider groups. So there's the issue around access and affordability of the right device and an affordable connection. That is a key component. And obviously, during the pandemic, we saw lots of people cut off to the safety nets that they had through perhaps libraries and the ability to go in and use devices and internet connections there. We heard stories about people, you know, hiding in the toilets and Tesco's to be able to use the Wi-Fi on their phone. So we need to be able to consider that group who live in poverty, can't afford a connection, and how we enable them to access that connectivity. And the final piece of the picture, the third and final piece, is really about the skills and ability to interact with services confidently and effectively online. And this affects a much wider group that, you know, just because that you are a confident user of social media and you can, you know, use Facebook or you can send an email, doesn't mean that you're confident in filling out a form online. So actually that needs to be considered, or that those three components in the delivery of public services and not leaving those people behind.
Thank you very much for your answers there. I'm just going to move on to my next point, then I'll bring the other witnesses in. And I'm moving on to the Connecting Scotland programme, which is a joint digital strategy between the Scottish Government and COSLA to ensure that nobody's left behind and has access to the internet. Now, I'm just going to give you an example. I had a constituent get in touch with me several months ago, which was about digital exclusion. Unfortunately, she suffered a stroke 7 years ago and is now registered blind. So she likes to be self-reliant. She pays privately for care. And she was becoming increasingly frustrated as everything she tried to do, she was told to do it online. With her online shopping, she rang the council, so she was told to do it online. If she was trying to book something, she was told to do it online. And she did not have access to a computer or the internet at the time that she got in touch. Now, since we have been able to get her a talking laptop. But my question really is, how do we ensure people like my constituent who may not be on the council or socials radar are not excluded and left behind? And there's a few other points to this. And what can local authorities and other public bodies do to counter digital exclusion as we move forward to a digital delivery? And are the affected bodies organised in the best way to achieve this? And do they have the necessary capacity and skills? I know that's a lot of questions in one, but what I might do is I'll bring in, if I can, Mari Miller from Glasgow City Council.
Thank you, convener. Certainly, my experience primarily in licensing over the last 2 years is that, you know, I've been hugely encouraged by how well people have adapted to that move towards online, whether it's for our licensing committee and licensing board meetings, that ability to join via the online platform. There have been a small number of cases where people have experienced a difficulty with that, and, you know, we've taken steps to assist. I think in terms of things like online application forms, because we had to move at considerable pace and respond to the COVID situation very quickly, they probably haven't been developed as well as what they could have done. I think that there is a significant piece of work still to be done in making the online capability for application forms and all of those processes much more accessible. And I think that is obviously that there's a significant resource will be required to do that. But I think we are able to build upon the experience that we have gained over the last 2 years, where we've had to, you know, respond in an emergency situation, but take that forward and use that to really improve the digital accessibility of our systems. But I do recognise, I think there is a need across services for more of a hybrid approach to recognise that there are people who aren't able to engage exclusively with online services.
Thank you, Mary. Can I bring in Douglas Hendry from Argyll and Bute Council, please?
Yeah, thank you. I would be in broad agreement with the comments of all three previous speakers in respect of the different ways they came at the basic question. I think it is the case that levels of accessibility to the internet, to people doing their business digitally, have increased very significantly, driven by COVID. I also think it would be a mistake, however, to equate access to the internet with ability to use the services. Some people may be able to access the internet and digital services, but for a number of reasons that others have highlighted, they may choose not or be unable to actually use the facilities that are available. In terms of how we might improve things further, I would also make the point that for rural areas, Argyll and Bute in particular, there are parts of our area where broadband capability, the speed of your connection is a mile away from that which people in more built-up areas, certainly in our cities and so on, can generally access. That is also a limiting factor for people who reside in more rural, remote areas, islands in some cases, and so on. The solution to that, I believe, is something that local authorities and others can contribute to, but ultimately it needs to be taken forward on a wider front. And that's something that obviously the Scottish Government has in hand, but it goes beyond even what the Scottish Government may wish to do. We need to be doing more for remote and rural areas with the providers of service to increase the rollout, to expand the quality, the speed, of the connections that people can make to the internet. I think that's all I'd say at this stage.
Okay, thank you very much. If I can bring in David McNeill again, and specifically, David, I don't know if you've got any guidance on what local authorities and other public bodies can do to counter digital exclusion as we move forward to digital delivery.
Yeah, I think the really important thing is that if we move to digital services, that all services take on board some kind of responsibility to supporting people that are not confident to do it, that it's not just passing people off that can't, you know, engage with that service online to, for example, the library or another service. And I think going back 6 or 7 years, I can't remember the specifics, but there was in the move to, you know, online claims for farmers in particular, in a group, you know, that wouldn't necessarily be in your traditional digital exclusion group, a lot didn't have access to the internet, not familiar with technology. And I know in that transition that plans were put in place to, when someone came into a local office, they supported them to go through the online system and the online claim with them in that office, to build their skills. And that not only benefited them from future years, that they were able to self-service and do the claim themselves, but they had reports back that, you know, they were more confident using technology, and it benefited their business because they were able to buy things online and get things cheaper and interact in a way that they wouldn't. So that was, I mean, that's going back almost a decade, where digital exclusion was slightly different, but just shows that a public service supporting people that are not confident online or need support with skills can benefit their own service and have wider benefits for that individual too.
Thank you. Some good, very good points there. If I can move to Muir Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd just like to follow up some of these points the Convener raised about digital exclusion. I was very taken reading the submissions. There's a clear difference between the approach being made by professional organisations and bodies who in the main are very relaxed and indeed enthusiastic about a move towards digital engagement, as opposed to members of the public, some of whom will have concerns, and we've already, you know, talked about this issue about how this might widen inequalities in society. And just to pick up the last point, David McNeill, that you made about the need to try and provide support for people who might be digitally excluded already. Maybe I could put that to Fiona Blair on behalf of the Registrars of Scotland. I mean, what thinking have you done in your organisation about how a move towards online is going to impact on people who are digitally excluded, and what specific measures can you put in place to try and assist those who might have some difficulty?
I think really my experience in the pandemic has been mainly older people who are digitally excluded. We in registration do most of our, obviously pre-pandemic, we were doing everything in person. When the pandemic hit, we moved to remote registration of deaths, and we found that people are quite happy to speak to you on the phone, although it's quite impersonal for some people. Some people really like that. It was mainly the emailing for older people, and they weren't digitally savvy. They didn't have access to emails. So it was just like finding a workaround and, you know, posting documents out to them, taking time to explain things. You know, we wouldn't necessarily be asking people to fill in forms online. So I was really just, and everybody has got a phone these days. I did find it difficult in one registration where somebody was deaf. And luckily, and unfortunately, she also had mobility issues, which meant she couldn't attend an office. So luckily she was tech savvy, and we did the registration via email, back and forward. And although it took a long time, the two of us got there in the end.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, just looking at the bill, sections 18 and 20 do give registration officers quite a degree of discretion as to how you offer remote registration of births and deaths. Have you got any thoughts, Fiona, about how that's drafted? Do you think that it strikes the right approach in the bill?
I do think it's the right approach. I do think it's a, you know, bringing in remote births as a policy progression. But I do think that there are occasions where in-person registration is far better than remote registration. For some people, there's pros and cons to each side. You know, with people who are vulnerable, with people who have, you know, disabilities, that need an in-person registration, that should never be denied from someone. But remote registration has its benefits as well for people who don't live close to a registration office. You know, people in rural areas that have to travel long distances to carry out an in-person registration, and also being from the Scottish borders, we have people who have babies in the borders from England, and, you know, that's a remote registration would save them travelling back to Scotland to do the registration, because, as you'll know, an event which occurs in Scotland must be registered in Scotland.
Yeah, thanks very much. Maybe I could ask Douglas Henry to get some perspective on this from a local authority point of view?
Yes, thank you. If I just make a comment first about the experience here, we found that remote death registration, which came in over 18 months ago now, and is perhaps further along the road that we're talking about for births, was a success. The benefits that were perceived to come from that have been fully realised. We've carried out surveys, that customer satisfaction surveys, that indicate that the majority of people who have been using the service appreciate the process being able to be done remotely, finding it less stressful in general terms, and in the context again of a rural area like Argyll and Bute, where we have perhaps a presence or had.
We've lost you. We've got a bit of a technical
issue. Home working hours are more remote in rural areas. The introduction of being able to do things remotely has been positive. Specifically in relation to birth registration, then the current position is, as people will be aware, we've got a hybrid approach in place, but there's still a general requirement for physical attendance at a registration office. We actually think that moving beyond that would be positive. We do not see, in Argyll and Bute terms, any real negatives with still doing. We're informed, as I say, by our experience in relation to how we've dealt with registration of deaths. And coming out of that, as councils move to whatever new arrangements they're going to have in place for the delivery of services, it is clear that what will not be happening is a replication of what was in place pre-COVID. So there's a clear opportunity to do things differently, to make better use of the technology, to make better or fuller use of the people currently working in this field, and generally, just to sum that up, no real fears about the position in relation of live birth registration if the model is moved on as is envisaged.
Okay. Thanks very much, Mr. Henry. And maybe I could just go back to Adam Sakura from Age Scotland. I mean, you know, we've had quite positive feedback there about what's being proposed. I mean, are you generally satisfied with what's in the bill around this, or do you think there are additional measures that need to be put in?
I believe that within the bill, that on the face of it, there are pretty satisfactory in terms of, well, what the provisions are, what the services are that will require or can be expanded to that kind of digital option. There is a slight concern, very slight in this, about what the next phase is, what comes next, what else will maybe kind of move to be primarily digital, or indeed where the provision for sort of non-digital communication and routes in actually is disregarded. So the person, the sort of citizen, in that sense, isn't being afforded that option. I think that's just where the trickiness might be. So the way it's kind of written and the type of things that the bill is covering, you know, broadly fine. But I think this is about how people apply it and how it's used and what might be the easiest thing to do. But hearing from other people on the panel about their particular areas, as a feeling that it's working well, that is good. But the one caveat to have in this is we often don't hear from the people who haven't been successful at communicating digitally, because we wouldn't. Phone lines from councils are shut down, face-to-face services shut down. And I think this is part of the future. I think we've also got a caveat on the last household survey in terms of the methodology and getting the truest picture of Scotland. But looking to the year before, you know, 500,000 over 60s in Scotland didn't use the internet, and 600,000 over 60s didn't have a smartphone. We're starting from quite a high place in terms of digital exclusion, and I don't think we're anywhere near that being cut to the levels that might feel that digital a primarily digital kind of service provision is acceptable. And if your English isn't your first language, if you've got sight loss, if you've got lots of different reasons why your life is already tricky to interact with public services.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful.
Thank you. Alex Rowley, please.
Thank you. I'll maybe just pick up from where Murdo left off there, Adam, and pick up with yourself. So the panel, for what I'm picking up, are broadly welcoming, I think, this part of the bill and see it as a positive. So given those concerns that are there, I mean, should there be within this bill something that says that the public can access these services face-to-face? Should there be some kind of protections built in? And if so, what should those protections be? Adam?
I think there are better experts with regard to that delivery than I on the panel. I think, but you make a very good point about there being maybe stronger provision for accessing things offline. And I think the challenge that we've seen, as I was saying to Mr. Fraser there, has been where folks just can't interact online. And some challenges, I'll give some examples. Well, it's not part of this bill or through the part three in any sense, is people trying to access applications for a blue badge at local authorities, but it's essentially all online to do so. And if disability is a big driver of digital exclusion, then they're having to go through many, many fiery hoops to get there. And I think the part of this, which is a slight caveat, is, as I said before, is making sure that the person's right to access it in a non-digital way is clear and that they're empowered to be able to do so. I think that is the challenge. But, you know, on the face of this bill and the reading, there very well could be enough there. But I think this is about how the public services actually enact it and what kind of scrutiny is given to their use of that. And I think the challenge for lots of things in terms of digital communication and notices, notifications, well, they're on the website somewhere or they're stuck on Twitter, might not quite cut it for many people who want to be engaged. But again, there are really good answers from folks about how their experiences of their services are working. But again, just making sure that we're hearing from those that we wouldn't normally hear from.
Okay, thank you. And could I pick up with Mary? I mean, you said, Murray, that in some senses the systems that were brought in out of necessity. So has there been an evaluation carried out by any local authority of the experience so far? Because you did say that you know, there was room for improvement in systems. So has there been an evaluation? Do local authorities, for example, know where those improvements are needed? And what are the barriers to that, i.e. cost?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we've certainly been, in terms of licensing, been engaging with some of our main trade group representatives, for example, taxis and private hire cars, on the experience of those online application processes. And I think, obviously, we recognise that we engage with a number of people where perhaps English isn't the first language, and that has been a particular difficulty with some of the online systems. And I think that is something that we do need to work on in terms of how we improve the engagement and that experience of moving to online. I think one of the difficulties we have is where we haven't been, for example, been able to fully resource the phone lines that we had pre-COVID, where people are able to pick up the phone. And I think, but we are moving in that direction of trying to channel shift people towards the online systems. But I think we do need to recognise that it does have to be done in such a way that ensures that everyone can properly engage with the process. And I think, yes, there is further evaluation that has to be done on that. Licensing more generally, I think, on having meetings, for example, online has allowed people to engage with meetings that they may not have been able to do before because of the time they would need to take to attend a meeting in person. So that's something, again, we want to take that experience forward, where people are able to join remotely, even if we move to face-to-face meetings again, that, that we do build in that capability for hybrid meetings, because I think it does allow for people to engage in the process that, that might not have chosen to do so in the past, particularly people maybe objecting to licence applications. So I think that there's a lot of experience that we need to take from the last couple of years and really carry out that evaluation process.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, can I maybe pick up with you, because local registration offices are given quite a lot of discretion under 18, Section 18 and 20 of the bill, the extent to which they are able to offer remote registrations of birth, deaths, the methods, etc. Is there a danger that you end up with 32 different setups, and some local authorities you can go face to face, others don't? So should there be clearer guidance given to local authorities so that people are not excluded, whilst encouraging greater take up of the online tools that are there?
I think there was a slight glitch in the broadcast. I missed the very first part of that, but I think I have the gist. If I miss anything in this comment, then please feel free to pick me up. In general terms, I think I recognised the comments made by my colleague from Glasgow a couple of minutes ago. I think that the future is hybrid for licensing hearings, be the liquor, be the civic government, or so on. And I think that it would be wise, sensible, appropriate for the local authorities, councils, to have the discretion in that regard for those type of hearings. In terms of general guidance to apply across all 32 local authorities, then I think that may be possible and desirable if it's a statement of a set of principles. But the nature of the 32 councils is that they're so disparate that it would be, I would suggest, impossible to produce a detailed set of guidance that all councils had to follow in.
We've got a technical issue. Alex,
in a reasonable manner. But as I say, one size fits all, I don't think would do.
Okay, thanks. And David, can I maybe come to you in terms of my experience when Universal Credit was being rolled out? I visited a number of projects, third sector projects, local authority projects, where there was a lot of intensive support being put in place because people were having to use, as you know, the online tools and register and search and you know what. And for a lot of those people, it was difficult. But there was a real attempt, certainly with the local authorities that I was involved with and third sector organisations, to actually support. Is that something that needs to accompany this bill? Does there need to be a recognition that there will be greater support needed at community level, and should funding be made available for that?
Yeah, I suppose to the universal credit example, you know, spent a lot of time ourselves and others, and including working with DWP, touring the country, supporting people to understand that that how to support people through that application process, because it's a big system, and it took me and my trial around 45 minutes to go through it, which is a big ask for someone that's digitally excluded. I think one of the key learnings around universal credit was that if you couldn't access it online, there wasn't a phone, or there was a paid for phone number. So if you were digitally excluded, you had to pay for a phone to phone and complete the application over the phone. That was subsequently removed, but wasn't built in it at the start. So that was further excluded people that were digitally excluded. So that was a key learning there. And obviously, universal credit is touching the kind of high risk of digital exclusion, because it is working with the people that are already facing poverty and other forms of exclusion. We talk about that the best way to support people is through embedded approaches to digital exclusion. So people that are working with the most excluded need to consider how that they support people to get online and be confident. And that's the way that we've delivered Connecting Scotland, by giving a device, an internet connection and digital champion support to people to pass on those skills to their service users. I think the challenge that we're seeing now is, as we go back to more kind of normal modes of service delivery, the capacity of those frontline staff to deliver that digital champion role and support people is limited. So I think there is a need for support for people, but actually that support really needs to be targeted at the organisations and teams that are working with those already likely to be facing digital exclusion, who are facing poverty and other forms of exclusion. They're resourced effectively to support the people that they already work with, rather than necessarily seeing digital exclusion as something on its own. Having said that, there are some strategic interventions that are needed to support people with to provide the infrastructure and skills and affordable connectivity.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I move to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, convener. I mean, maybe if I could move on from the actual access to the kind of accuracy of information that comes through to whoever's registering births, deaths, marriages, that kind of thing. Maybe I could start with Ms. Miller. I mean, is there a risk that if everything's done remotely, that, well, let's take marriages to start with, that, you know, there could be a kind of sham marriage where somebody's there's not a real relationship, it's to do with immigration perhaps, and would that be easier to pick up if it's face to face than if it's remote?
Certainly from I've been speaking to our registrar colleagues, and I think there is a concern around the potential for those types of issues where these things are done remotely. Obviously, checks and balances are built in, but certainly the experience has been that being able to do these things remotely doesn't always mean that it can be done more quickly by the registrar services. Often face-to-face, error mistakes and errors can be corrected very quickly. Where it's done online, there can sometimes be a sort of back and forth, and that can sometimes be, certainly in the situation of registration of death, that can be something that actually can, you know, cause some distress. It may actually, you know, prolong the registration process. These are issues where we do need to consider what the impact of having these services remotely. But yes, I think Fiona possibly would be able to comment more on that potential issue you said there about the sham marriages.
Yeah, I'll come back to her, but maybe I can just pursue you a little bit more on some of that. I mean, for example, with deaths, because the registrars had raised the point that maybe they get wrong information and then that has to be corrected. Is that a complex process, correcting these things or making changes?
I think it's just more time consuming than where you have that face-to-face registration and these things can be checked there and then. It does involve, obviously, emails or communication going back and forth. So it really is just that issue about it taking longer to complete the registration So often, if we're waiting for information to come to us, it can be the perception that the local authority is holding up that registration process, but we may be waiting for information to come that could have been resolved more quickly face-to-face.
OK, that's helpful. Thanks. So can I move to you, Ms. Blair? If you've got some thoughts in this area, I think you had some concerns about information around deaths.
Yeah. So, can I just come on to sham marriages first?
Yes.
Nothing's going to change with this bill with regards to marriages and the fact that people will still submit their notices. And it's at that point where things are just not quite right. We've got a list of guidelines to look out for sham marriages. So therefore, these things are picked up and dealt with. A marriage schedule will still be given out, a wet signature applied. It would only really be remote or digital when it comes back into the office. So it's really like a background function. So that's not going to change. With regards to deaths and changes, it is harder over the telephone, I'm not going to lie. And, you know, getting the right information, sort of teasing out people. People don't understand that when you ask if someone, the deceased person, what their marital status is, and they say, oh, they were single. And then I always qualify that with, oh, so they never married. And then you find out they're actually divorced. So it's just proper questioning, you know, an experience. With regard to like remote death, to make changes can be quite time consuming for the registrar and also quite intrusive for the informant, because after you've done sealing a registration, you then have to get evidence to make that change, and that evidence needs to be sent, not in all circumstances, but in some circumstances, then up to the National Records of Scotland, and then the change is made by what we call an RCE, a Register of Corrected Entries. And that can be quite time consuming. And then you're in the stage of then reissuing new extracts to the informants with the corrected documents.
Yeah, and I mean, I get it that, you know, you raise the issue of funeral directors, and obviously they won't know all the facts, so they're dependent on the family giving them the right information, all the rest of it. And I know my mother died just a year ago, and I was very dependent on the funeral directors and really appreciated their support in guiding me through the whole process, because you don't go through it very often as an individual. I mean, does the idea of doing things digitally online, does that make any difference to that? Or have we just got an inevitable problem that people getting information through?
Yeah, I mean, I think what we're going to be offering is people choice. They'll have a choice of an in-person registration or the choice of a remote registration. It's not that local authorities will move only to remote registration. That's not my understanding of it. My understanding is the National Records of Scotland will engage with local authorities shortly to find out, you know, what the best method is for them. But in-person registrations will come back, because they are important for people who have disabilities, who are vulnerable and who need support. My sort of like a problem with funeral directors is funeral directors can actually register deaths at the moment, you know, and they are the last qualified informant under, you know, anyone else who has knowledge of the particulars of the death. So like, for example, and where someone who has came on holiday, had a diving accident off Eyemouth, you know, it wasn't appropriate pre-pandemic for their family to travel up to Scotland to register the death. And in that case, a funeral director came in on their behalf, registered the death with them, on knowing that the funeral director was in doing that appointment on the telephone in case I needed to know anything further. You know, I don't see, it's not like it's going to be an online forum for someone to fill in. My problem is that, but essentially funeral directors will be relaying the information from the informant to the registrar. And that is something that could easily be covered by remote registration. I think it's a case of giving people choice. You know, do they want the funeral director to do it, or would they prefer to do it directly with the registrar? I would hate to think that a funeral director would charge someone for doing that service, because death registration is free and you only need to pay for the extracts that you purchase at the time of the registration.
Yeah, I mean, I think my experience was, I mean, the funeral director wasn't cheap, but I mean, they just did it all as a package. So I can't even remember now exactly what they did and what I did. I mean, you made the point that it's easier to pick up sometimes mistakes, or, you know, the point about being somebody being single or divorced, if they're actually there, if you see them face to face, because you can read the person. I mean, that's true of me and my colleagues as well. It's better face to face. And I just wonder if there's a problem if we go more online. I mean, just to switch another one would be births. And I think there's issues around births as to whether there's only one parent on the birth certificate or two. And again, is that not something that would be easier to deal with face-to-face?
I think that, obviously, it's younger people who are having babies. And I do think there is, I mean, at the moment, as the other panel members suggested, we're doing a hybrid version where we're taking the information all over the telephone, make an appointment for them to come in, check and sign the register page. I do think that as a natural progression, you know, we've run remote very successfully, we actually progress to doing remote births, because all in cities find it easier to make an in-person appointment, pop into the registration office. People in rural areas find they're travelling a long distance to a registration office. You know, in the borders, it can be something like 18 miles to get to the registration office. Now, if you have had a C-section, that can often be difficult because you need to get somebody to drive you. Dad's back to work. You know, I do think there are occasions where it would be beneficial to have that service, but also offer choice in an in-person registration. That is not going to change. You know, I think local authorities need to offer that service.
Okay, that's very helpful. Sorry, I mean, I realise I've focused here on Ms Blair quite a lot. I don't know if any of
that's
the other... well, sorry for you. I don't know if any of the others are wanting to come in with any points. Have we picked that up? No. Well, that's me then. In that case.
Thank you. Can we move to Brian Mitchell, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I was very struck when I was listening to David McNeill, his testimony there. I think he suggested quite rightly that being on the internet doesn't mean to say that you're confident and knowledgeable enough to navigate form filling or applications. And I think the concern for me is those who are furthest removed from mainstream society are the ones that are, you know, that was an issue pre-pandemic, and the pandemic has exacerbated that. You know, are we in danger here of forgetting about a section of society here and leaving them behind, do you think? You're on mute.
It's come through. Well, I think the key theme that's come through is around choice, that a digital service isn't necessarily the only option, that there are backups for people so that no one is left behind. I think having said that, and partly to think to the previous point about kind of form filling online being difficult, actually to create a really good digital public service is a complex job. It involves understanding user needs, engaging with users, doing lots of testing, and that bit falls down. I think even setting aside for a moment the issues around people who can't access the internet and not confident, the average reading age of the UK population is 9. So in terms of filling out a form online, if you have to design a form to do it really effectively that could be completed by a 9-year-old, because that's how the majority of the population can read that. And yet lots of our public services probably make things much more complicated. So, and it is a real skill in being able to design those digital public services with that, so that we get the right things in and people are not confused. But definitely there's the issue around choice and having backups to online. Because the reality is that 80% of the population will want to engage with an online service, and it's how we support those that struggle, that want to, and those that perhaps don't want to or can't access an online service.
Thank you. That's helpful. I think if I could just take that a little bit further, I think, you know, the third sector does tend to be the main interface between those kind of communities and services and councils. So it's really, you know, if I ask what the role of the third sector is in ensuring that these issues are brought to the attention of people like us, people in the councils, and how, therefore, as part of this strategy, moving to digital, we ensure that, you know, that there is that improved communication, if you like, between council services and the third sector.
I think where we've seen it really, really strong, places like Renfrewshire have put their digital public services transformation strategy pre-pandemic, put digital inclusion right at the heart. That before embarking on a change of a service, they were considering the needs of users, and they have established a very strong partnership with the local third sector interface, with housing associations and others that came together and said, how do we collectively solve the issues around digital exclusion and that we so that we're confident in developing our digital public services. So we've been working very closely with that partnership in Renfrewshire, and to look at place-based approaches and how they support people. And it is about developing that and the service in tandem with the digital exclusion support with the third sector and the public sector, and indeed the private sector in terms of connectivity, all working together. And we're beginning to see other councils adopt similar partnership planning and coordination approaches, which is really to be welcomed.
I wonder if Douglas Hendry can give us a perspective from the council.
Yeah. I think to reiterate a comment I made in a different context earlier in the proceedings, there's no one-size-fits-all approach right across all of Scotland. I agree with the comments of the last speaker in terms of the general approach. I think that from a local authority perspective, then digital exclusion links to a number of key or core themes that authorities should be pursuing. Poverty in the widest sense, but there are all sorts of poverty, not just purely financial. Other types of exclusion, yes, again, part of the overall picture. But it's clear, I believe, that it is going to be absolutely necessary. There will be no alternative other than to develop joined up arrangements which go well beyond the remit of the local authorities. That's there at a wide level in terms of community planning and factors like that that we can pick up. But the role of the third sector, voluntary organisations.
Seem to have lost.
Right, bring us on again. The nature.
Oh. Well, you're back. I can hear you.
Oh. Yeah. So, and the nature of the country, the areas within the country, are such that delivery in areas like Argyll and Bute, remote rural. But to work in the widest possible base, it would not be appropriate, sensible, possible for local authorities to try and do this on their own. So, absolutely key, joined up working across all interests, looking to target the people that we need to through a whole range of mechanisms that will be quite different, say, in Tyree, perhaps, than they would in Glasgow. But ultimately, it's, again, local solutions for local people, if I can conclude on that point.
Okay, just a quick, if I could segue a little bit to Mary Miller here. Some local authorities did express some concern that holding remote meetings and hearings might limit public attendance. I wonder if that is your experience and whether you think that there should be support in amending the bill to make sure that applicants can present in relation to licences and have input into the format that a hearing should take.
Yeah, I think if to go back to sort of 2020 when we first launched our fully online meetings, I was really, really nervous about how our applicants and objectors, members of the public, would engage with those services. And I actually have been very, very surprised as to how well people have managed the online meetings. And I think that's probably everyone's experience that, you know, even those who probably were very apprehensive have had fairly positive experience of dealing with these online systems. And even people, as I said, where they may have we've had to contact them and provide just some additional guidance on how to join the meetings. We have had people who haven't been able to use the system, and we've made alternative arrangements, for example, and been able to phone in to meetings. So I think it has been generally very positive, but I don't think going forward that we would necessarily choose to hold meetings exclusively online. Certainly, I think speaking with my elected members, I don't think that they get the full experience from having the meetings fully online, certainly in terms of being able to take direct advice from myself and other officers, and being able to, like, things quite a dynamic meeting situation. And I think just being able to get advice more quickly at the face-to-face meetings. Certainly, having spoken to a number of the licensing agents, I think they prefer the face-to-face meetings, because you lose some of the nuance of, you know, facial expressions and the indicators of perhaps where their submissions are going. But I do think probably my experience over the last 2 years is that we've seen more members of the public actually engage where the meetings are online, just because of the length of time that often meetings take, that they may have to, you know, take a full day to come along to an online meeting, but they've been able maybe to continue working, but sit in the background of an online meeting and join at the appropriate time. So I think it's about trying to find the right balance, and I certainly think having the ability to hold hybrid meetings going forward is a really important amendment to licensing legislation, but allowing local authorities that choice as to what is the best format, and making that decision through engagement with all of our various stakeholders.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'm just going to go back a wee stage to points that John Mason was raising earlier on, if it would be possible to direct this to Fiona. The guarantee of an in-person registration. Scottish Government's position is that the effect of Section 18 to 20 is that the local registration office must offer in-person registration to any individual who desires it. Is that your understanding in the reading of the bill?
Yes, it is my understanding at all. They'll offer choice to customers of a remote registration or an in-person registration. It's not going to take in-person registration away, because that is important. And I think the way the bill is drafted, it doesn't need to be guaranteed in a prescribed, say, circumstances. It should be offered as a choice to people.
As we go forward and more people take up the digital option, do you see there being problems as we go further down the line with smaller and smaller numbers of people looking to have the in-person meeting being able to be accommodated? Do you see that being a problem in the future?
I don't really see that. Certainly from Borders' perspective, I don't see that being a problem. We will still have to have registration offices. People still need to come in with marriage notice forms, collect marriage schedules. I can't see that ever changing, you know, collect certificates if they don't want it posted out because they need it quickly. I don't see that ever changing.
Okay, thanks very much.
Not in the near future anyway.
Okay, thank you. Could I just turn to the local authority discretion? And there's an awful lot of discretion in the current drafting given to the local authorities. Is there not a concern that local authorities have got too much of the discretion, and the people who are making the applications for licences don't really have a say in the format of how the meeting will be held? Mary, would you be the best person to answer that?
Yeah, I think probably the point that Douglas made earlier, that a one-size-fits-all isn't going to suit all local authorities. And I think, you know, the geographical area, all of that kind of thing is something that is important in making that decision. But I think you're absolutely right. I think that certainly for a licensing authority in choosing which format to move forward with, I think it's important that we do engage with our stakeholders, whether that's trade groups, community council representatives, licensing agents. I think all of that is important in another understanding what the experience has been over the last 2 years and what is the best format moving forward. But I think it's important, yes, to have the option to deliver, whether it's fully face-to-face meetings, whether it's fully remote, or to have that hybrid model. But I do think it is important to take account of all those who are involved in the process.
So the same idea when the question that I just put to Fiona, there's nothing in here that says a local authority must give the option. Do you think that that's something that should be added to the bill?
I think it is important that we do engage. So I think it's difficult because of the difference across local authorities. So I do think it is important that local authorities retain the discretion, but I think in deciding what is the best format, there should be an obligation to fully engage with various stakeholders, and whether that is done through a consultation, a formal consultation, or a more informal processes, that's perhaps something which maybe the bill should reflect.
I'm going to press you a wee bit on that. When you're saying it's the local authority should still have the discretion, regardless of whether you live in a remote area or not, I live in a remote area myself. If I'm dissatisfied with the decision that a local authority has taken on the basis of how a meeting or an application is going to be held, there's nothing more frustrating than not being able to actually stand and speak to somebody face-to-face. And if the local authority has that final say on that discretion, where does that leave the person who feels dissatisfied with the fact that they can't actually have a sit-down face-to-face conversation? Surely there should be some provision in the bill that allows people to say, no, I'm sorry, I'm not happy with that, I want to sit down with somebody. Would that not be something you would consider?
I suppose whether we're talking about application forms, for example, that there should be the ability for these to be done face-to-face. I suppose it's the resource that would be required if we are moving more towards a digital model, what resource would be required to deal with those who contact us and want to meet face-to-face. It's certainly something which we would hope to be able to do, but again, it's difficult given the circumstances across all the different local authorities as to how that would be facilitated.
So it's easier for the registration of births, deaths and marriages to be able to hold that, because they will always have that requirement for an office, but not for local authorities when people are trying to deal with licensing.
Well, in terms of at the moment in Glasgow, we haven't reopened our service desk. What we have done is extended our phone lines since they were diminished over the lockdown period, where we did have staff working exclusively remotely. We're bringing back our services, but there will need to be a decision taken as to whether we reopen our face-to-face service desks. It's not something which has been raised with us as a particular issue. I do think certainly the majority of people applying for licences are now very familiar with those online processes, but I agree that we do have to allow for the fact that some people will want to retain the ability to lodge something as a face-to-face and have that interaction with a member of staff.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Thank you. If I could just ask one quick question, just going back to what my colleagues Alex Rowley and Brian Whittle did raise, and it's regarding the digital exclusion and community support for people that don't have access to the internet to fill in forms. And I note, David, that you did mention about Renfrewshire, and it was interesting to note also that a digital champion coordinator is crucial in building a digital ecosystem for Renfrewshire. Has that is that a position that has been put in place in Renfrewshire?
I believe that's now in place, and the partnership in Renfrewshire has been around for quite a while. So they've been quite at the cutting edge of digital exclusion, and I know what they felt is there's lots of good organisations in the voluntary sector, as well as teams within the council, that are doing good work to support people around digital exclusion. I know the challenges that they were facing around were capacity and abilities to do that, and knowledge about whatever things going on. So the coordinating role was really to help people access additional support that is available within the local authority or the and share resources. And that coordinating role is key to alleviating some of that capacity pressure and finding extra people that can support, whether there's more specific needs around, actual physical accessibility or connectivity that direct organisation might not be able to provide.
Thank you. I think that they've been very proactive and maybe lessons can be learnt by other local authorities by Renfrewshire. I'll bring in Alex Rowley.
Thank you. I wonder if I can go back to Adam and ask, in terms of older people in particular, is there good practice that has been developed around this whole digital agenda? And in terms of the bill itself, or this part of the bill, is there any specific amendments that you believe could improve, particularly for older people, access to digital services?
It is also mentioned this, there's a lot of it in the third sector. I think it can be potentially over-relied on by public services at times, almost that, well, if they're doing it, we can rely on them to take care of it and we'll forge our path. You know, I'm thinking of different parts of the country, people like CLASPA in Ayrshire help older people get online, build the confidence, as much as anything, and kind of like people of similar ages working with them, as opposed to, someone a lot younger just kind of showing them how to do it. You kind of work with your peers to understand it and recognise, what the kind of tools are there that they can kind of make your life easier or more fun. And actually, I do recall a study a few years ago which looked at as soon as they allowed or they had kind of free access to Wi-Fi in some care homes, that their data usage was through the roof. And it's because the residents were playing online games and nothing, people didn't expect this kind of thing. It's just when there are opportunities there that people can make the most of it. But I think there's, I'll sort of go back a couple of points here, but one of the concerns in this, and I think in terms of the items in this bill which are looking at kind of more digital kind of routes to take care of them, they seem fairly fine. I think the bit that was mentioned earlier on with regard to the discretion of local authorities, and I think precedents that this bill might set for future future services kind of moving online or primarily, is that I think people should and must have the option for non-digital routes for lots and lots of different reasons. And part of this is predicated on the fact that we're never going to get to a position where 100% of our citizens are online or are online confidently for lots of reasons. And I do know that the Connecting Scotland programme, which as I recall is with £40 million of investment, has gone into that. It might be more, and David will know more. When I last read the impact report, about 40,000 people had been supported. I don't actually know how many older people were in that. I think they were one of the first tranches and the early part of that. But after 2 or 3 years, is that kind of investment going to need to come in again to just to top up those that have been accessed? It might do, and is there a will and the finances to do that? I do not know. So I think that's a great initiative, but I think it also kind of tip of the iceberg of what is required. So I think broadly in terms of amendments, I think, I Mr. Fairley's point about kind of the discretion of local authorities, I think it is good, because I think at times you can see that it's maybe not putting the kind of citizen as the start of this. What might be easier to deliver a service could be online and remotely, but actually is that making the most of what the person needs, and are we fulfilling what their rights are, accessing them and making sure, as I said before, not jumping through too many hoops to get there.
Okay, thank you.
Great, thank you. Is there any other questions from members? No? Great. I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise on how you can do that. The committee's next meeting is on the 31st of March. We will conclude our evidence taking on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1 with the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery. We will also consider the outcome of the next ministerial statement on COVID-19. That concludes the public part of our meeting for this morning, and I move it into private for the next agenda item. Thank you.